Okay, so welcome to session 2B of the last day of the conference. Our next speaker will be Markus Heinrich from the University of Düsseldorf and the University of Cologne. And he will tell us about why the axiomatic and operational approaches to resource theories of magic do not coincide. So, go ahead.
Thank you very much. So my name is Markus Heinrich, and I want to talk a bit about the resource theory of magic today. In particular, I want to talk about two different classes of operations in this theory, which I refer to as the axiomatic and operational class. So this was joint work of Anna Heimendahl and David Groß at the University of Cologne. And we put the paper on the archive by the end of last year. And in the meantime, I actually finished my PhD, and I moved now on to the University of Düsseldorf. So let me start with a short motivation. So the mindset for this work is the magic state model of quantum computing. And the magic state model is probably the most famous approach to fault tolerant quantum computing. It requires you to prepare certain special states that we call magic states. And in fact, you don't have to do this perfectly, but you can also prepare noisy states and then use something called magic state distillation. So this distillation actually, if you look at the numbers, it requires a vast amount of resources, and that's why people refer to this process as a magic state factory. And so one problem in this model is, of course, that this overhead is really dominating the resource cost in running a fault-tolerant quantum computation. So people are actually working on trying to improve this magic state distillation protocols to have lower and lower overheads. But from a theoretical point of view, it would be nice to know what the optimal overhead could be and how to maybe also how it can be achieved. So this has led people to work on the resource theory of magic, and the goal is to quantify the magic resources that are needed in a certain quantum computation. So as it turns out, this endeavor is closely related to the classical simulation of quantum circuits based on the stabilizer formalism. And this is in fact made precise by certain magic monotones. And the value of these monotones is exactly related to basically the simulation overhead of a classical algorithm that tries to simulate a quantum circuit with that amount of resource. So from a general resource theoretic point of view, it's possible to bound, for example, distillation rates in terms of resource monotones. And so from this point of view, it would be also interesting to know whether these bounds can actually be achieved. And in fact, we know that the distillation protocols that are out there so far, they cannot, I mean, they basically the rate that they can achieve is a few orders of magnitude less than what we can get as bounds. So the question is basically, how can we achieve such bounds, or are they actually achievable? And the magic state distillation protocols that are out there, they mostly use so-called stabilizer operations. And from the so to say general point of view for resource theory, there's also a different class of operations that one can use to distill. And this is what I call the axiomatic class, and it is given by the stabilizer absorbing channels in our scenario. So the thing is that not much is known about these classes from the resource theory point of view, and in particular, it's not even known if they're the same. Yeah. Okay, now it is because that's the content of our paper. Okay, let me start a bit by introducing what stabilizer operations are. So stabilizer operations can be defined operationally using a certain recipe, if you want. So a stabilizer operation is a quantum circuit that allows you to prepare and measure in the computational basis, and it allows you to apply certain unitaries, namely the phase Hadamard and the control NOT gate, and you are allowed to use classical randomness and classical control throughout the circuit. So the unitary part, so the phase and the Hadamard gate I wrote here on the right, they are Clifford gates, and they in fact are the generators of the so-called Clifford group. And so any circuit that contains only Clifford unitaries are referred to as a Clifford circuit. And a well-known result is then the Gottesman-Nil theorem, which basically tells you that any stabilizer operation can be simulated on a classical computer in a time that is polynomial in the number of qubits. So from a quantum computation point of view, these stabilizer operations are not really powerful. At least they are not more powerful than a classical computer. I mean, in other aspects, for example, stabilizer operations are powerful because they, for example, can generate highly entangled states. And so, for example, for QKD or something like this, this is actually sufficient. Okay, so how do we go from stabilizer operations to a universal model of quantum computing? And here the magic states come into play. Basically, it's known that certain diagonal gates can actually be performed using magic states. For example, the famous T gate can be done using this T state and a short gadget, which I call the state injection circuit. And the important thing is basically that the state injection circuit takes the input state, the magic state, and then performs only stabilized operations. Yeah. So every time I want to do a T gate, I can do instead consume a magic state and do this little gadget here. And now, in fact, since Clifford unitaries plus any non-Clifford gate is actually universal for quantum computing, this magic state model is also universal. And moreover, I also wanted to say it can also be made fault tolerant because once the stabilized operations are fault tolerant, the whole model is fault tolerant. And in fact, you can also use noisy states and distill them using magic state distillation. And in this magic state distillation, importantly, you only have to use stabilized operations. Okay, so in this model, it's perfectly clear that the resource for quantum computing given by magic states. So it's a good basis for building a resource theory of quantum computing. And to talk about this, I want to first look at resource theories in general. So in a general resource theory, what you do is you single out a certain subset of state space and you call them the free states. So the free states are the states which do not contain any resource for the task that you want to achieve. And then we also have something like free operations that are simply all operations that cannot generate resources. So in particular, they map free states to free states. And I would say that for these free operations, there are basically two natural choices. And this is the operational and the axiomatic choice. So once you have like certain, once you know that certain elementary operations cannot generate resources, you can stack them and give an operational procedure of how basically free operations can be performed. And on the other side, the axiomatic point of view is basically somehow like a maximal approach. So it simply defines the set of free operations as all channels which map the set of free states to the set of free states. So let's do a little example and use a well-known entanglement theory. And here it's clear that the free states which do not contain any entanglement are by definition separable states. And the operation of the axiomatic class of operations are simply the well-known LOCC, the local operations in classical communication class, and the class of separable channels. And here there's also a classic result, which is already out there for over 20 years, which tells you that LOCC is not equal SEP. In fact, there's a bit like a more fine-grained result, basically, which gives you a nested chain of classes, where basically LOCC is labeled now by the number of rounds that you are allowed to take in such an interactive protocol. And you can show that basically if you increase the number of rounds, you get basically strict containment of the classes. So how would it look like for magic theory? So here we define a set of free states as all the states which can be prepared by a stabilized operation. And this turns out to be a convex polytope that we call the stabilizer polytope. And I have to put it in a short disclaimer here. I'm actually talking about qubits here because in higher dimensional systems, the theory actually looks a bit different. And so this convex polytope is actually the convex hull of so-called stabilizer states. So these are all pure states that can be prepared using a Clifford unitary. And for a single qubit, these are simply the six Pauli eigenstates. And the stabilizer polytope is the octahedron that sits in the Bloch sphere. So this is a very, very nice and very cute and simple example, but it doesn't reflect at all the situation.
Sorry, we can't hear you right now.
Markus, we can't hear you. Markus?
Told that one cannot hear me. Is it better now?
Now we can hear you again. Yes.
Okay, that was strange.
it was quite some time though. So maybe.
Ah, okay. And okay, fine.
You can go back a bit.
Okay, I'm sorry. I think there's something had. Like, how far back?
Maybe a bit more.
Okay, that's unfortunate.
Maybe from here. Let's say so. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, I'm very sorry for that. I hope this will not happen again. Okay. So what I was about to say was that so we have this set of free states which are given as the polytope of spent by stabilizer states, and we have now basically this operation in this axiomatic class given by stabilizer operations. And completely stabilizer preserving channels that map the stabilizer polytope to itself. And now basically what we did is basically we characterized these classes a bit because it's actually not much was known about these classes. And we constructed an extremal CSP channel that basically is an explicit example for a CSP channel, which is not a stabilized operation. And so this shows in particular that the two classes are not the same. Okay, so let's talk a bit about these completely stabilized preserving channels. So maybe Alexander, if I like just, if I'm not like, can't not be here ahead anymore, like maybe just wave into the camera because I somehow cannot really.
Yes.
Yeah. okay. So let's repeat the definition. So as we call a super operator completely stabilizer preserving, if it maps the stabilizer polytope to itself. And we even require that this still has to be true if we tensor the operator with the identity. So this is a complete analogy to the complete positivity. And in fact, it's a nice little exercise to show that any CSP map is actually completely positive and trace preserving. And for the complete positivity part, it's actually it's sufficient to observe that the maximum entangled state is a stabilizer state. So if you look at the choice state of a CSP map, it's a convex combination of stabilizer states. So in particular, it's PSD, and therefore the map is CP. Okay, but more interesting, there's another lemma that you can prove, namely the choice state of any CSP map lies in this stabilizer polytope in the choice space. And but it's also, the channel is also trace preserving, so it fulfills the trace preserving condition. And this is actually also sufficient, so you can show that basically the image of the CSP set under Choi-Chan-Minkowski isomorphism is exactly equal to the stabilizer polytope intersected with this affine space of TP preserving, of TP channels. So this basically gives us an opportunity to basically write down a CSP channel explicitly as a convex combination of stabilizer states. And furthermore, we impose the TP condition by hand. So how would this look like? So basically, if you consider n to n qubit channels, then one can show that any bipartite 2n qubit stabilizer state has a particular form. So it can be, you can basically explicitly write down the Krauss operators that this this state corresponds to in terms of a Clifford unitary U and a stabilizer code projector P. And then you have to add this normalization factor, which is basically, so 2 to the k is the order of the stabilizer group of the code. Okay, so what we can do, we can now use these cross operators to write down a CSP channel. But we furthermore have to impose that it's trace preserving. So we have to impose the equation on the right-hand side, which then only involves the projective part of the cross operators. Okay, and now this has a nice interpretation, namely a CSP channel is basically an instrument that performs a certain PUVM, which has the form of a generalized stabilizer measurement, if you like. And conditioned on the outcome I of the measurement, we can perform a Clifford unitary UI. So let's give a few examples just very shortly to get an intuition. For example, we can simply leave out the projectors, set them all to the identity and get a mixed Clifford channel. We can furthermore, for example, take the computational basis and project onto them. And then basically we get defacing channel, which has a conditional Clifford part. In fact, we don't need to use the computational basis, but we can actually use any stabilizer basis. And there are a few more examples in our paper. But the important point here is that basically any example that you come up with basically immediately involves orthogonal stabilizer codes. And then you can check basically that all these examples are actually stabilized operations. So to find something that is not a stabilized operation, so somehow need a non-orthogonal solution to this PUVM condition. And that is something that is not like completely straightforward. No? In fact, it's difficult. But what we were able to do is we could find such a solution, and it allowed us to define a channel that we call lambda here. And our Seidel theorem basically says that this channel is a CSP, and it's in moreover not SO for more than 2 qubits. So let's have a short look at this channel. So what does it actually do? So if you can understand it as a three-stage process, where in the first step you do a projective measurement with respect to the zero state and its alpha complement. And that basically block diagonalizes your density matrix with respect to the upper left entry. Then you deface with probability 1/2, and this sets all off diagonal elements to half their value. And then in the last step, you perform a global Hadamard condition that on the zero outcome in the first step. This will leave you exactly with this density matrix up there. And now, interestingly, once you leave out one of these three steps, this thing is not CSP anymore. In particular, for example, if you leave out the second step, the defacing step, then basically this measurement and the conditioned application of the Hadamard is not CSP for more than 2 qubits. What we also found is that this n larger than 2 condition is actually sufficient because the two sets actually coincide for a single qubit. And that's not like super surprising because for a single qubit, basically all measurements that you can do are orthogonal. Okay, so now how do we prove that this is actually how we prove the central theorem? So our strategy is to first prove that this is a CSP channel. And that's kind of easy, but maybe not from this form, but from the canonical form of CSP channels it is. Then we prove that it's extremal within the CSP set. This is totally not obvious. And it's actually like a few pages of proof in our paper. And why do we prove that it's extremal? We need this extremality to basically discard it as a stabilized operation. And this step might also not be really obvious. Let's give a short technical sneak peek. And I want to start by the last step, and which involves not showing that it's not a stabilized operation. So the question is basically, how do you separate actually stabilized operations from CSP channels? And that's not completely obvious, but this observation is really useful. So if you consider simply a Pauli measurement, then basically what you can show is that if you conjugate the input with a Pauli set operator in this case, then nothing happens. And because you can basically assume that the first operation in a stabilized operation is always a Pauli measurement, this led us to the conjecture that stabilized operations have such a Pauli invariance. Of course, it's not always true because, for example, you can have convex mixtures of stabilized operations. You can have basically measurements involving ancillas. So, but you can all discard basically all of these cases by an extremal assumption. Yeah? So we modify the claim a bit. But then there's also the possibility that you can have Clifford unitaries acting on input and ancilla, and these you cannot really discard. They can be extremal. So we have to adapt the claim again a bit. And basically what we came up with is like this theorem, which basically says that an extremal stabilized operation has a non-trivial Pauli invariance or is a Clifford dilation. Sometimes it can also be both. And then basically what we do is lambda is extremal. It is not a Clifford dilation and it does not have a Pauli invariance. So by this theorem, then it cannot be a stabilized operation. So that's basically the logic behind the whole thing. So let's quickly go over this lambda channel again. So how do you come up with something like this? And here the credits really goes to Arne. And basically what we did is we were looking for extremal CSP channels. And the reason for this is basically that they are far outside in the set. So they're likely to not be SO. We need this actually for this Pauli invariance theorem. They are also like interesting. The extremal set, points of a convex set are always interesting. And in this case, it's interesting for simulation questions. And in the end, we are simply math nerds and we like to be nerd sniped. Okay, so, and how do we show that this thing is extremal? I mean, you can basically from convex geometry arguments, you can show it's a unique solution to a vertex construction technique. I don't have the time to go over this here, but maybe I can come back to this later or during the roundtable session. Yeah. Okay. Finally, let me summarize what we did. I would say that basically the resource theoretic point of view on the magic state model is quite interesting. It has and it brings together like basically two communities, if you want, and basically there's still a lot to be explored. So I would say this theory is still a bit in its infancy. And our contribution here was basically to study these two classes of free operations, in particular the CSP class.
The audio is gone again, Markus.
Okay.
Now it's there again.
Can you still see my screen? No, no.
No, you have to share it again.
I don't know what happens here. Maybe the university internet connection is not the best. Who knows? So when did I lose you?
No, just now.
So. Okay, thanks. Okay. Okay, so basically our contribution was to study the CSP channels and construct an extremal family actually of CSP channels which shows that this class is actually strictly larger than the stabilizer operation class. And okay, so this has, there's a, like two really interesting routes that one can pursue from based on this finding. So one route is basically to go into magic state distillation, and basically the result basically opens the possibility that there's a noticeable gap in magic state distillation rates. So it could actually be that optimal magic state distillation can only be done with CSP channels, and you lose a lot with stabilizer operations. But at this point, this is not at all clear. So okay. And the other direction would go into towards the classical simulation direction, because it seems very plausible that CSP channels are classically simulatable. And because the class is strictly larger than stabilizer operation, this would go strictly beyond the Gordas-Monil theorem. So first attempts were already done in this direction, but however, the details still have to be filled in. Thank you very much.
Go. Okay, thank you, Markus. So let's, I think we actually have a bit of like, maybe a bit of time to do some questions. So Richard Küng asks, would your story change if you choose to ignore forget stabilization in the definition of a stabilizer preserving operation?
So I think I can do not really understand your question, Richard. What do you mean by forget stabilization?
So maybe until he, I mean.
Yeah, but maybe I try to answer that later in this lecture or whatever. So yeah.
Yeah, so I have a question. So you mentioned at some point that things change if you consider qdits instead of qubits.
Yes.
Can you comment on this? Like how does this
theory look like? This is related to this Wigner function and phase space business. So basically in odd dimensions, there's this there's the Wigner function, and which gives you like a non-negative representation of stabilizer states on a discrete phase space. But in fact, there are more states that have a non-negative representation, and you can basically show that, for example, a stabilizer operation cannot basically induce negativity. So basically, it is necessary to have a negativity in the Wigner function to basically get a quantum speed up. Yeah, because the set of non-negatively represented states is strictly larger than the set of stabilizer states, this would be the set of free states. But this also changes the definition of the axiomatic class, because stabilizer preserving channels are actually meaningless in this from this point of view. So you have to talk about like basically non-negatively represented channels if you want. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Maybe another question, like in this resource theories. I mean, does it make sense to? So you said that the free operations should be somehow completely stabilizer preserving. Would it make sense to drop the completely there, to just look at some more positive maps that preserve stabilizer operations? I guess they would not be operational, but
yeah, I mean you could do this. I mean, for example, you have the transposition map, for example, which preserves the set, actually preserves the stabilizer polytope. And there, okay, for basically for qubits, that's it. In higher dimension, there's again more, but for qubits, basically, I would actually conjecture that's basically the only thing that you get in addition. But there's like there's a little catch to it. But I would say that's the only thing that you get in addition, like the transposition. So. So it can make sense for from the mathematical point of view, but I guess from a physical point of view, it doesn't really make sense.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. And so further discussion, I guess, in the roundtable, I will post the link in the Slack channel. So thank you.
Thanks.